y'all. Welcome to another episode of Source and Company. I'm your host, Source, of course. You can always follow me on Instagram and Twitter at Smitty Source on both of those. And of course, you can subscribe to the Source and Company YouTube channel. All right. So, you know, we like to bring in people that have some type of connection to the 804. We're doing that once again. All the way from LA, he is a videographer, a photographer, a video director, including JoJo Siwa's crazy boomerang video that I just found out has 875 million views. 875 million views. That's a dumb number. But anyway, he's done more than that. We'll get into a little bit of that. Thank you for joining me. Today's company, Monseé. How you doing, bro?
What's going on? How are you?
Oh, man, I'm doing all right, you know. COVID-19, so we making it do what it do, but it has allowed for some positives, so here we are. How's things been going for you in the pandemic state?
In the pandemic, man, it's been a good time to just, you know, sit back and sharpen my tools and learn things I didn't know before or didn't have time to learn before that I can apply to my craft once all of this clears up and get back to it. I've been basically taking a lot of, I've been taking advantage of the time.
Yeah.
For sure.
What's wrong with that? I know some people are like, you know, if you don't come out of this with a new skill, you're doing it wrong or something like that. I'm kind of like, I get that. And I mean, I'm trying to take advantage of it, but it's a lot, like, especially for people that are struggling mentally, financially, it's a lot, especially if you're alone or with someone that you don't want to be with.
So
once again, I appreciate you joining me. Let's just take it back. Well, first, let's just go back to the beginning, I guess. You're from VA.
Yeah, from Alexandria, Virginia, like right outside of DC. For those who don't know, I grew up about, technically it takes 8 minutes to get to the White House from where I grew up. That's where I'm from, and then I moved down to Richmond to go to school.
Did your love of, I guess, the arts, I guess it's a love of the arts, right? That's what you call it. Did your love of the arts come from that time, or did was it more translated when you went to VCU?
I mean, it's kind of interesting. Like, in my case, it's a little different because, you know, I had my mom, she was a scientist.
Okay.
And my dad, he was an architect, and, you know, my dad was an architect in the military. He's like real high ranking and all that stuff. And so they were all about like education and all that stuff. Meanwhile, I grew up in the area where kids were kind of bad, and I didn't actually want to go to college, but being that I was good at drawing, like illustration was my thing. I was always the kid drawing all over the desk during class. Mm-hmm. I always had to answer the questions, but I was definitely drawing all over the desk just to pass time. You know, I didn't want to go to school, but I ended up going, and it was definitely a good decision because I learned a lot of things that I apply today that helps me, you know, and not like in the talent section. It's like the people skills and business and just learning how to prepare yourself just to be on time, you know, like having to be on time to classes or you risk getting an F and not having a school bus picking you up, making you get there, you know, like you have to have a lot of discipline. So I look at school, you know, that's some of the things that I learned from it that I value the most. For sure.
What was your major?
I majored in communication arts and design, and I did a double meditation of digital imaging and kinetic imaging, which is basically film animation and graphic design.
Dang. But you were used to a heavy load and you came from a scientist and an architect, so I guess you could handle it, clearly.
Yeah. I mean, you know, my mom was a single mom. My parents were separated, so my dad lived in North Carolina. My mom lived in Alexandria, so I was always traveling back and forth. And, you know, we weren't like, you know, I didn't grow up with a silver spoon. You know, as time went past, you know, my mom started to develop a lot more, like, just knowledge and financially growing in her company. She worked at the same company for 20-something years. You know, that's how it was back then. It's a lot different now. People are like,
And just, I mean, from when you were in Richmond, of course, I see and hear your name pop up in conversations with different hip hop artists, people. I didn't know, you know, what your connection was at first, and then it was like, he does videos even back then. So at that point, it was it the dream to do the whole move and videographer?
Nah, man, my mom just like, you're not staying here. You either gonna go to school or you're gonna go to the military. So I put in some applications. I got accepted into VCU. I went for the art program to be an illustrator. While I was there, they were like, oh, you know, you can do digital stuff. You can do this and that. And then they basically opened my eyes to all the different ways that I could use my talents. And so then that's why I ended up majoring in multiple things. And I was always in class because it was a way that I could actually exercise my creativity, you know? And at that time, you know, like taking video classes and things like that, I didn't know exactly what I was going to do with it, for sure. Right. I was just knowing that I liked doing it. And so once I got closer to graduation point, you know, I met a few people and it's just kind of happened.
If you didn't, like, just to jump forward, if you didn't have the success, I call it success, I don't know what you call it at this point, but if you didn't or weren't having the success that you're having up to this point, would you still be able to function with that degree? Like, I'm thinking about people that take classes that may or may not translate to a lot of different things. Is that something that could translate to a lot of different things? Like, you said double major, so I guess yes.
Yeah. I think just with the overall effect that it's just a communication arts degree, like that comes in so many forms of communication of arts. I mean, right. Like what we're doing right now, that's an art form of communication. So, you know, that could apply to this particular situation on a super grand scale, you know. I think it could translate over from place to place for sure. It just depends. You got to be creative these days, though. You know, you got to be
creative and multiple streams or multiple, I guess, skills.
And motivated.
How long ago did you bounce out to the West Coast?
I've been out here going on 4 years now.
I don't know why. I mean, maybe I hadn't seen, maybe I just hadn't been paying attention enough, but I felt like you were out there longer than that. It feels like you've been out there for a long time just from seeing it on like Instagram.
Yeah. No, I as far as basically coming out here is going on 4 years now. And then prior to that, I was being flown back and forth out here to do stuff. So I was out here visiting here and there, like, you know, like a few different projects.
That's probably what it is. And okay. So you credit your, and when we were chatting back and forth, you kind of credited a couple of Richmond people to, for your start, between skills, mad skills, Lonnie B, and my man Re-Rock, who I just talked to not too long ago. What was it? Was it just the the hip hop connection? What was it that got y'all?
Yeah, man. I mean, like, this would be a funny story. I don't know if we have time for it, but
you good? Yeah.
Basically, like, how it all opened up. I went to the club one night with one of my buddies, and that buddy was a mutual friend of me and DJ Re-Rock. At the time, I didn't know Re-Rock, and this was at a time when I was in my like junior, senior year of school, something like that. And we're standing at the bar, and we're all, you know, we have our drinks. We got a little loose at that point, and Re-Rock is like, hey, man, you know who I am? And I'm like, nah, I have no idea. And he's like, yeah, I'm DJ Re-Rock, you know, Just Those Music Awards, DJ nominee. He's the man, you know. But prior to that, I had no idea. And then he's like, yeah, take my mixtape. And this is, you know, this is like the beginning of the mixtape era in Virginia.
Wait, I looked at it. This isn't the Jordan jersey, the North Carolina jersey one, is it?
Yeah, that's the one. I'm pretty sure that's the one, yeah. And so he shows me it, and remember, I'm like in school, I'm in art school, like dude, like on the way out because I'm finishing up. So my skills at that point, I'm a little confident, you know what I mean? And he shows me the mixtape, and he's like, yeah, dog, check it out. And I'm like, man, this joint sucks. was like, who did this? And he was like, who are you? And I was like, I'm nobody, but I can deliver you something better than this. And from that point, we just like, he was like, yo, let's talk about it. And then I made his mixtape cover, and then he introduced me. And then he's like, yo, let's go over to my boy DJ Lonnie B's house. And I'm like, oh, you know, Lonnie, that's cool, you know? And so he takes me over to Lonnie's house. And Lonnie, this is back when like, what was it? H to the is O, B to the is A. Lonnie broke that song for us at his house. Like, it wasn't even on the radio yet.
Wow.
And yeah, so he's like, yo, listen to this. And we're like, wow, this is crazy, JC, you know? And so I'm like, this DJ Lonnie, he's the man, like, this is crazy. And so Lonnie's like, yo, just make me a logo. And so he had a logo with the little, it was like a B, and it looked like a hand holding a microphone and a B. So I made that for him, and he introduced me to Skills. And then like we did Born Unique's album, and then he introduces me to Clef. Me and Clef became brothers, basically. You know, Clef, all the Apple gangers, you know?
Right, true, that's true.
Yeah, yeah. Like his girl one time, him and Clef and me. Now I was walking at the time with my shorty, and then Clef's girl at the time saw me walking with the shorty and then yelled at him later on. Cause she was like, who was the shorty you were walking with? I saw you with someone, cause we just resembled each other that much. So like, we just called each other doppelgangers, because I was like the good guy, and he was like, you know, Clef, he's wild, young, and I was always chilling, that style.
Yeah, Clef was a good dude, man. Rest in peace, Clef Dollars. Absolutely. Yeah. Even I'll just mention this. I mean, even to this day, I feel like Clef does not get enough notoriety, credit, appreciation for the work that he put in. Like, that dude put in work, and nobody really knew unless you knew, you know?
Yeah, he was working with like Lil' Kim, and like back then, M.O.P., and he was working with a lot of people. No one knew. Yeah, he was beautiful.
So you moved out to L.A. How does one survive in L.A. being from, well, okay, so you did say you went back and forth before that, but even with that, how does one survive in L.A.? Because L.A. is not cheap, and it's kind of like you got to know somebody to know somebody. So how do you survive in that type of environment?
Man, I got really lucky. Like, there's a really close family friend of mine. It's my homeboy Ben. Some people know him as Don. I call him Ben because that's what the family calls him. But yeah, he was already out here, and you know, I came out here and was hung out with him. And one day I was over at his studio or at his place, and then there was like, he had some of his clients over, and like there was the girl, and she comes up to me and she's like, what are you doing? I'm sitting there working on my laptop, and she's like, what are you doing? And she's just, you know, all of my stuff. And I'm like, who is this girl? You know, I don't even understand what's going on. There's a girl from Danity Kane. So it was like Ariel Day. So like, yeah. Today she's a homie now. So if she ever sees this, it'll be hilarious. And she comes over and she's like basically like pressed up against me. I never met her. And she's like, oh man, whatever you're doing on this computer is really cool. When I was editing. And then one of her projects was getting edited over on the other side of the room. And the director of the video, his name is Alfredo Flores. And you know, if you ever looked him up, he's like an incredible dude, man. Like, incredible dude. He was standing there, and like whoever was editing was like, yo, I don't know how to do X, Y, and Z. And you know, I'm sitting there, and I was like, oh, just hit like, and I gave him a shortcut keys to do it. And they were like, what in the world? Who's this dude? You know? And Alfredo was like, man, what's up, yo? And then him and I, we talked, and I was like, dude, I'm here, I'm bored. I'm just out here visiting my cousin. I call him my cousin, family friend. And I was like, so if you need any help with anything while I'm here, bro, just let me know. I didn't know Alfredo at the time, and like, who he actually is, even to this day. But he's like, yo, man, what you doing tomorrow? And I was like, I'm here. I'm not doing anything. It's kind of like now. It's COVID season. Right. I'm sitting in the crib, man. So he was like, yo, meet me here tomorrow, 2:00. I was like, all right, cool. And then I get there, and I'm next thing you know, I'm filming with Sierra and helping direct her music video. And then Sierra's like, yo, like, I like the footage that you took, because there was three cameras that were going. So Sierra loved the footage that I took. And then they were flying me back, or not, Sierra wasn't flying me back and forth, but I was just coming back out to visit. Management was like, yo, you in town? Like, we need you with Sierra. So I was with Sierra, like, in the studio all the time while she was recording her album and all that stuff. Yeah, man. So, like, I got really lucky as far as, like, Bible mode goes. You know, I was right place, right time, with the right skills. I did pre-prepare, because had I not had the skills that I had at that time, when the opportunity presented itself, it would have been, you know.
That's it. That's the truth right there. You were prepared for the opportunity, and the opportunity presented itself.
Yeah.
Crazy. That's crazy.
This bracelet on, young, like, it, I don't know if you can read it there, but it says, Amat Victoria Cum, and it's Latin for victory loves preparation. So, like, I'll always wear, I have a bunch of these, but I always wear them just to keep me as, you know, as a reminder to stay sharp. Because, you know, just because your opportunity ain't there right now don't mean it's not going to be there. And when it does come, you better be prepared.
That's real. That's real. And it helped that, well, you had the opportunity and that friend, your homie.
Yeah.
Like, relationships. The young lady, I mentioned her to you before we started recording. She's been on Broadway and different things. And she was saying, the people that I went to school with end up in these other places, and then I don't see them for years. Then they hear I'm in the business. They hear my name. Boom. You know, it's a connection, because they already know they can trust you and you already had a relationship. So,
yeah.
Yeah, that preparation. Ah, man. That's a lot of people need to hear that, though. So we skipped over how you actually started in the business. Well, as far as your first project outside of, I guess, the area, was it the Beanie Siegel joint, or?
Yeah, I guess that was probably like my first. That was my first big video. That was like my dream video. Like, one of my favorite artists of all time is Beanie Siegel. You know, like The Rock, like. Jay-Z was always cool, but I just felt like without Beanie Siegel, Jay-Z was not, he didn't have the same amount of street cred that catapulted his career to where it's at. I'm sure there'll be like a lot of, like, you know, coming back with that, but whatever, that's how I feel. But yeah, man, I was with BJ, which is Clef's manager at the time. BJ, he was like, yo, let's go to the Roots show. And I was like, all right, cool, you know. And of course, Skills was part of, like, the Jam Boys and, like, Truck North. And, like, it was all of them. It was cool. So I went with BJ, and, like, we're backstage running around. And, like, at the time, I was working with a clothing line that I was starting up called Just for Kicks. And it was, like, all about, like, sneakers, you know. So I was getting drops from all of the people around. Like, I had drops from, like, Ryan Leslie, all kinds of people. And then, like, Beanie Siegel, he's on stage, and he gets off stage. We're in Philly. This is, like, his territory. So he gets off stage, and, like, everyone's like, yeah, yo, Beanie, Beanie, Beanie. And, like, he wouldn't stop for no one. He just kept, like, bullying his way through. He's the Broad Street Bully. So he was just, like, going through the crowd, and this is all backstage. And, like, I saw him, and I was like, this is an opportunity. And so this is how I got him. And it was really cheesy, but it is what it is, and it worked. So I stood in front of him and was like, yo, Beans. And he was like, yo. And, like, I was like, yo, you were, like, my favorite artist, dog. I was like, and the best part about it is we both Pisces. I was like, your birthday is the day after mine. And he was like, yo, word. Yo, take my number, son. Yo, we gonna talk after this, yo. Yo, my man, you, but yo. Yo, and he just, like, it was the strangest thing. Like, we clicked just because we had the same birthday, day off with the birthday, man. And, like, he was like, I'm going to call you. And I was like, all right, cool. So I gave him my number. And, you know, like, people say these things, like, yo, take my email, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Like, literally after the show, he called me, put in contact with his manager and I, like, you know, we chopped it up. And he was like, yo, Beanie has a song with Travis Barker and, you know, write up a treatment so I can pitch it. I was like, all right, cool, you know? So I wrote it up, and he pitched it. Next thing you know, I was doing a music video. It was Travis Barker, Beanie Siegel, Bun B, Kobe, and they were all featured on one song. And I did this video. We went to Philly. I rented out the penitentiary. $850. They cleared out all of the inmates and took them to the West Wing. We actually had to go through the check-in like the prisoners. So it was like you hear it all the tar-tar-tar as you go through. And yeah, man. So I got to do a video with Beans. And then after that, me and Beanie talked on the phone like every day. And he was just like, yo, I like cooking. He was giving me game on like how to gamble and like all kinds of stuff. And then I would go up there here and there, kick it with him. It was crazy. And then,
wow, that's dope though. And you gotta, I've been in situations when I was younger where you see somebody that you wanna stop, you wanna talk to, you gotta hit them with something different because they already getting the same information from different people. You gotta hit them with something different to make them be like,
yeah, it was random. It was at a point where I think he just registered it, where he was like, we the same. I'm like, yeah, I mean, you know, like you're my favorite artist, dude. There's gotta be for a reason, not just because you deliver dope bars, but you as a person, there's just things about you that's dope. Everyone has their flaws, you know, but like at the same time, like that comes with the territory. Sun don't exist without night, you know, so it's like, it's dope.
That's wild. And recently, I mean, it's my cousin's husband, my blood cousin's husband, actually rocked with Beanie a couple shows last year when they were in Lynchburg and think in Philly. Named Raj Rashid. They live down in North Carolina, but yeah, with Beanie and Freeway and them. So crazy. Yeah. I'm gonna have to mention that to him so he can bring your name up, spark him up.
Yeah.
So a lot of your stuff that you've done since then, where did Australia come into the mix? You spent some months in Australia.
Yeah.
How long ago was that?
Actually 2 years in a row. I didn't go this year for obvious reasons, but I usually go once a year for, well, actually last year I did China instead. So I went to China for 3 weeks, but, Australia was the year before and the year before that. Basically I had a client that was out here. They were out visiting and, I work a lot with Sony, and one of the people, they were managing this person, that person. They were like, hey, we need you to help with doing like some BTS footage, 'cause we're basically trying to, you know, kind of like show the buildup of an artist with this particular artist. So so we just clicked, man. And then her mom, it was a girl, her name is Brittany Maggs. Actually, if you look her up now, she's blowing up in Australia, which is dope. She's like my little sister now. They're like my second family. And so I went out there and they were like, yo, come out and, you know, help us with stuff and just hang out, you know? And so they showed me around and I just ended up being out there for like a very long time. Started getting homesick and everything, but it was tight.
Australia, when I think Australia, I think of things that can kill you.
Facts.
I don't know a lot about Australia, but I know it's a lot of things that can kill you.
And yeah.
Whatever the case.
Yeah, this stuff is there, but I saw like a crazy snake once, you know, it was dead on the street, so that didn't count. And then I saw it's like the world's most deadly spider, most venomous spider, and they go into pools. Like they can survive in water, and they do this thing where they do something and they create a bubble around themselves, and they can live in water for like 2 days. And so like I'm out there at the pool, and this family, they're, you know, the Maggs family, you know, like they're basically the CEO of Samsung all of Australia, because they are the largest distributors of all Samsung product in the entire continent. So how that they live is like very, very different. So my experience in like just going into Australia, and you know, I wasn't really put in any situations to see anything too crazy, but the house that we were in, you know, it's an amazing house, you know, big, giant, high-tech, everything operated on the iPad. I'm standing in the kitchen, and I'm like, oh, you know, blah, blah, and I hear something, and I'm like, what the hell is that? And I look up where the sound was coming from, and out of the vent, the air vent, crawled a spider, and this spider is called a huntsman spider. If you look it up, it's called a huntsman, and it's basically about this big, like literally like the size of, bigger than my hand. And it was on the ceiling, and I'm like, yo, like, what's that? Like, and they're like, oh. And the wife, she's like, yo, telling the husband, Jared, come kill it. And he's like, what is it? And she's like, it's a huntsman. And And then Jared, he's like, ah, let it live, it's cool. And then it crawls back up into the vent. And I'm thinking, damn, I gotta sleep here tonight. Like, and there's like, you know, like, y'all just let it get away. And I'm like, yo, is it poisonous? And he's like, nah, it's not poisonous, it'll just make you a little sick. And I'm like, that's poisonous, man. Like, he's like, nah, not in Australia. In Australia, if it's poisonous, that means you die. And I was like, okay, well, yeah, all right. So,
levels to this poisonous in Australia.
Yeah, that was my one of my only experiences of that. And there was a shark, they called for sharks when I was on the beach once. And there's blue bottle jellyfish, like just like a highly dangerous jellyfish.
Wow. So, yeah. Okay, that's an experience there, though. That's an what part of Australia was it?
Sydney.
It was Sydney, okay. Yeah. That was the guess, but you know. Yeah. Not like I had a lot of other choices I was going to go with. Sydney.
Yeah, like two. There's like two choices.
So back in LA, you mentioned that you ended up having to be, you were allowed to be in the office. I think Marlon Wayans let you pretty much crash at his office as far as birds are concerned.
Yeah. I was looking for a place, and I knew this one dude, and the dude had a camera, and then I had to go pick up the camera because I was renting this camera. So I had to go pick up the camera, and it happened to have been on the back lot at Universal. And then the guy that was holding onto the camera, you know, I had to interact with him, and we just started talking when I'm picking up the equipment. And he's like, yeah, you know, like, let's link again. And it happened that it's Marlon Wayne's nephew. So then after that, him and I, you know, we just became like very cool. And then, so then every day he's like, yo, let's come to the office with me. You know, where I was picked up the camera. He's like, come to the office with me. So I started going to the office, and he's like, yo, come the next day and the next day and the next thing. And next, you know, like 6 months later, Marlon like, yo, who parking in my spot? And it's like, oh, let me move my car real quick. So like now, you know, like we grow to like a little relationship, like me and Marlon still cool. Like saw him in the club the other month before all of this stuff, and we just chopped it up. I have like a movie pitch that I want to pitch to him. So like, we'll see if I can get him doing a movie starring or co-starring Marlon Wayans, preferably Will Ferrell and Marlon Wayans.
Oh, you got it mapped out already, huh? Yeah. The cast. Is that when you pitch a script, do you pitch it with a cast? I guess you pitch it with a cast in mind. I mean, I guess the characters are built around thinking about somebody, right?
Yeah, I think it might, maybe, I don't know. I think just as a director, you know, like I always try to give people a vision so I can make you experience like what I need from you. Just like if I'm telling you a story, then I want you to like experience in this fullness. So if I'm pitching a thing to you, I'm gonna be like, you know, the dude, he looked like Danny DeVito, he's this small. Like, you don't have to be Danny DeVito, but this is just what I have in my mind, and just right. To give a clear picture of where my head's at.
That's real. That's real. I've had this thought, this is random, just since you mentioned that, I keep picturing somebody remaking Let's Do It Again in Uptown Saturday Night. And I feel like that should have been a thing. I'm surprised it has not been a thing before now. I'm like,
yeah.
It doesn't have to be Will Smith and Denzel Washington. Like it could be, as long as black people care. Like it's somebody that black people know, it could be, you know, I don't know.
Michael B. Jordan.
Yeah, and I'm like, bro, disjointed. It's a perfect, those are perfect movies for black people, and black people are working. So you're getting all the black people. Insane, kind of like a Black Panther type thought. That's
yeah.
My head for years. I'm like, somebody got to do this one day.
Yeah, thanks. I'm with
it. I'm keeping hope alive. I'll keep hope alive on that. So a lot of your work that you do is dance related.
Yeah, a good amount of it. It's like 50-50.
Yeah.
But yeah, dance takes up a lot because there's a ton of dancers out there. And like, if you do good for one of them, then... Yeah, they will hit you up for sure.
I mean, clearly you've done well for a few, because you worked with the likes of Abby Lee. When I say the name, I don't even want to say the name. Abby Lee Miller.
That's my bag.
You can just stop right there and just say Abby Lee Miller. Like, my daughters and my wife had me watching all the episodes, whether it was every week, it'd be like 9 o'clock, whatever time it came on. They go, we gonna sit down and what? All right, so yeah, eventually you're gonna get into it regardless of what it is. So I was a fan of Abby Lee Miller myself personally.
Yeah.
How was that experience for you? Well, how is, I guess it's an ongoing experience, right?
Yeah. I mean, I was with her right before all of this happened, and I actually have to deliver a video that I cut for her. I have to put the titles on that joint and send it over to her. I should actually do that probably by Friday. But yeah, man, working with Abby is awesome, dude. Like, I've seen her make a lot of people cry. I've seen her be very, very rude to a lot of people. I just, you know, but that's just Abby, man. But one thing I can say is a blessing is she's never been rude to me other than the first time that we met. But I didn't know who Abby was the first time we met, and she didn't know who I was the first time we met. So we had a headbutt that I think that gave each other a lot of respect, to, you know, like, because I was directing a music video for, I was flown out to direct a music video for Kendall, which was another one of the
kids
characters on Dance Moms, and she had a single, and it was like a helicopter. We used the airplane hangar, and I had like a Rolls Royce helicopter in there, and like another helicopter, and there's like all kinds of stuff going on, and like, and Lifetime, there's a helicopter going by, of course, because LA is a ride. But she's like, she comes over, man, and I'm over there and I'm directing the music video, and then Abby shows up, you know, and Kendall, this is Kendall's song. I didn't know that Abby was paying for the music video. I just knew that I was directing it and I was just coming out to do my job. Right. So Lifetime was recording it. So there's an episode actually about this video. So of Dance Mom. So Lifetime, like, you know, so there's that, and Abby comes over and she's like, yeah, let's do this and let's do this. You know, when people are on set, oftentimes everyone starts feeling very creative and people like to put in their input and blah, blah. It's a natural thing. Right. But Abby is very Abby. So she's like, yeah, let's do this and let's do that and do this. And I'm sitting there like, damn, we've been shooting for 4 hours already. And she shows up and like, this lady is just like being, she's just bombarding, yo, like she's making the situation crazy, and we're on a timeline, we got finished by x, you know, x time, and this is on Super Bowl Sunday too, so I already want that to happen. So she's like yeah, let's do this, and I was like, okay, all right, cool, and then I just do whatever I want. And then she comes up to me and she's like, you're gonna stop telling me no. And I was like, no, I'm not. And then from that point on, we just had this thing where she's like, I don't know who this guy is. I'm like, I don't know who she is. She's Rodney. She's like, this guy he talked back. So we've just been super cool with her since. I don't know if that's the reason why she, you know, treats me like with so much love and respect, but I like to think that's the reason why. Because everyone else is a victim, dog. I see it. Like, everyone's a victim, yo, to Abby. I see it. She has no chill.
And that's, you know, I can see that being the reason. I mean, yeah, she's not used to it. Yeah. Not used to somebody bucking. So you're like, that's crazy. That's crazy though. I mean, that's a story right there. That's crazy. So yeah. You got her, Guy Groove.
Yeah.
Matt Stefanina.
Matt Stefanina, yeah. That's my
and mom. Ditto, you mentioned Ditto to me.
Yeah, Ditto. She's Ditto, man.
The funny thing is, you mentioned her, and that same night, my oldest daughter, put on a show, and it was like a magic, something that's on Netflix.
Magic show, the magic show.
Yeah, and they had the
free. For the first time, like 3 days ago.
Yeah. I don't know why my daughter is into magic all of a sudden. She finds it interesting. But yeah, and Ditto was on it. I was like, yo. It was just talking about her like 3 hours ago. So that was kind of crazy. So See what else you got. What else you got going on out in? What's going on now? As well, now you're still working though. Like,
yeah,
don't have to be out to work necessarily. I'm sure you got something going on, right?
Yeah. I mean, I like I said, I'm editing stuff for like Abby Lee. I've been doing a lot of editing, and also like photography. Like, I think that's dope because I get to shoot like editorial style, lifestyle imagery. You know, outside. In a place where I feel safe, you know, I wear my mask, but you know, if I have on a lens, I'm 6 feet at minimum away from the subject. So, you know, like, I think that's really cool. So I just got signed to 2 clothing lines. And they basically just put me on like a retainer where they have me shoot 2-3 times a week, you know, just building up content for their brand and doing product shots and all that good stuff. So
that's dope. So it can be freelance or they can sign you, even as a photographer.
Yeah, because like I think like I call it signed because you know basically it's written out and with my agent, which I got an agent this year for the first time in my whole life. but yeah, man, like so. If you know that you need a bunch, if you're a new company or if you're a company that's already established, whatever, like. You know that you're going to need a certain amount of content to produce and put out to promote your brand, you know?
Right. So
instead of going, hey, Monseé, are you available this day? Hey, Monseé, are you available this day? It's like, hey, can I just like put you on a retainer? Let me give you X amount of dollars per month. And then you deliver, you know, this amount of photo shoots or this many edits or this many Instagram videos or, you know, whatever menu you make up that you want. And then we figure out a price and then I deliver you product.
Does that make you an influencer though? Like in your mind, does that make you kind of an influencer?
I don't know.
I'm just thinking.
Yeah.
If, I mean, you're creating content, even though it's going through someone else. So
yeah, maybe. Brand ambassador. They made me like a brand ambassador, and I think the line is a woman's line. It's called the Heather Presley, and the line is a woman's line. Both of them are actually women's lines. And I'm like, they're like, yo, you should be an ambassador, and I'm like, I don't wear women's clothes. So you're like, $100 a month of free clothes, you know, and you get to pull whatever and take whatever you want. And I'm like, but I don't wear tights, you know what I'm saying? So it's like it doesn't matter. But then I thought about it, and you know, if you go on my Instagram, majority of my followers are females, so like therefore I can like, you know, push stuff to my female audience, and then I get kickback. So whenever they buy stuff using my name, they get a discount. I get, you know, paid for it, and like, so it's cool.
It's a beautiful thing. Another stream, man. Another stream.
Yeah.
I'd hate to make a hard left, but I don't wanna miss the opportunity to at least touch on, you mentioned that your mom had passed last year, and that was you said best friend, I believe.
Definitely best friend, rock. Like, you know, I wasn't not a mama's boy, but like, yeah, mama was, man, you know.
So she was still on the East Coast?
Yeah.
How does that, like, all right, so my dad passed. He lived in Atlanta. I live in Richmond. So, I mean, you can drive to Atlanta, but still, you're in L.A. She's on the East Coast. Not that you have to get all deep into what happened and all that, but did it happen have to be a thing where you had to come home and go back and come home?
Yeah. I used up a ton of frequent flyer miles going back and forth. But the first time when everything just like genuinely hit the fan, she passed away from cancer. You know how cancer works, like it just attacks different parts of the body and you just never know what's gonna happen. So she ended up, like, everything was cool. She was having all of her exams and everything was going all right. Stuff. And then I was in Atlanta directing a music video with Ayanis. It's an artist. Her name is Ayanis. She's like super dope. If you should look her up for sure. Super dope. Actually, her manager was Beanie Sigel's manager, which is the person who linked me with Travis Barker, which is why I still to this day talked and work with Travis Barker and his kids. So I was directing the music video for Ayanis, and I got a call that the morning I had to direct her music video, she'll tell you about this joint too. And man, like that, it was crazy. So I stayed and I finished and I directed the whole music video. And then after it was done, I rolled out and went and saw Mom Duke. But my brother was like, don't leave yet. I was like, I'm not directing the music video, but due to I'm so anal when it comes to like preparation sometimes, especially with products like that and a lot of money being invested and you got record labels and stuff involved, that I had written out like my entire shot list from like, you know, from 1 second, from 0 seconds to 15 seconds, this is what's supposed to happen. This person walks from left, this person walks from right with pictures and everything. And so they were like, yo, you can leave and we can finish it because we have everything right here, so we can finish it off. And my assistant director, he's like, I can handle it, dog. We went over everything a million times. But I didn't leave and I just stayed there. So my brother was like, yo, don't make no moves yet until we know exactly what's going on. So if you can stay, finish the video up and do that. So that video holds like a lot of weight, you know what I'm saying, with me. It's Ayanis' video and it's called Wait a Minute.
That's heavy. That's heavy. And you say your father passed years ago, like you said, 15 years ago.
Yeah.
And you specifically said that the reason I bring it up is because you specifically said that you are, you don't have any parents or something to that effect.
Yeah, parentless.
Parentless. Yeah. That's a heavy thought because, I mean, especially with your mom, you're saying your mom being your best friend.
Yeah.
I don't know. I just wanted to find out why you said that. Cause I mean, I see that you don't have your mom, your dad, but you said it, I feel like it's more to it.
Yeah. I mean, like sometimes, you know, especially with me, like I work with a lot of kids and I work with people of all ages, but like, you know, I see kids on a regular basis too. And just to see like parents interacting and like with me, like I was saying, with my mom being so close to me, I talk to my mom every day. So like when that's all gone, like a parent is one of those people that are in your life that you can, you know, you can like just look forward to hearing from them. If shit is like, we're in COVID season right now, I would love to be able to just call your mom or to call your dad and be like, man, how are y'all doing? Like, you know, or, you know, something even just personal, like where you like to discuss that with, you know, you don't just trust any and everyone with information, at least I don't. So, you know, for that matter, like, I feel like that's a good reason for parents, and parents are also like a way of guidance. And no matter how long a person lives, you know, like your parents are always going to be one of, well, for me at least, parents are always like a guide, you know, like a guide. And she's still, you know, my parents are still guiding now, which is crazy.
Respect. Well, rest in peace to both of them. I ain't gonna hold you too much longer, man. You did mention that you had, like, you don't get, you don't get starstruck is what you said. Or yeah. You're not really into the notoriety thing. That's not really your bag. You're more for the work than the art.
Yeah.
For the work than the people and the fame. But you did say that you were starstruck when you met one particular person, and that was
Ryan Leslie. Yeah. I mean, not Ryan Leslie.
It was definitely not Ryan Leslie.
Man, what I said. No, it was John Legend. It was prime John Legend, and it was wild because it was actually at that Roots concert.
Oh, where?
Yeah, it was at the same concert where I met Beanie Sigel, man. And like I was, you know, I was on the move and I was just running around and I'm like, oh man, like these are like, this is cool. And I hit the corner and I'm like looking back and I turn like this and then like he's standing there like, what's up, yo? And I'm like, yo, you Ryan Leslie. Like, and like he was just started laughing. I was like, yo, that's dope, man. Like, And I didn't, you know, I had national pictures or anything like that. Because I every time, you know, it's like Cardi B, working with Cardi B was cool. I was kind of, I don't know if it was like a super starstruck moment though.
When was that?
She's so dope. Like, she's so, so dope.
When was the Cardi B thing?
That was a few years ago.
Yeah. Music related or?
No, I was actually working with her doing, I was with her for 2 days. And day one was like some interview stuff. Day two, she was doing like photo shoot stuff. And like, yeah. And so like that was cool. Like, she's dope. Of everyone that I've worked with that is like on that level of fame, like I would say like her and yeah, she's probably like, she's just so cool. She's just so real. Like, she's so consistent. Like what you see of her, like just like an Abby Lee, no matter what the character is, it doesn't change. No matter who's around, no matter what she's wearing, no matter, she's just her. Like, every time I see her on TV now, I'm just like, she's just so the same. You know what I mean?
That's real. Yeah. I mean, that's what you, for a lot of people, for me, I mean, that's what you want from people, whether you like them or you don't like them. I know what I'm going to get. So it's not like you're going to flip-flop on me. I know what I'm going to get. So you got to respect that one way or the other. But if you get yourself around whoever, it's not anything better than that.
Andre Berto was a good one because, like, the way that I met him, like, his girlfriend at the time, her name is Portia. His girlfriend at the time, and they're together now. They're married and everything. And she was doing a photo shoot with one of my homies, and, like, she was there shooting, blah, blah, and then the door knocks, and then, you know, I'm like, oh, I'll grab the door while you're doing whatever you're doing. Open up the door, and it's Birdo. And I'm looking at him, like, man, and I'm a huge boxing fan, you know, so right. And I'm visiting LA too, so this won't, like, one of those things where you're just used to running into the celebs and, like, famous people or people at the top of whatever game they play. Yeah, and I was like, man, you look mad familiar. And it took me a while for it to sink in. But at the end of the jump, you know, I was like, yo, let's, like, yeah, I appreciate you, dude. And, like, no one knew who he was. There was literally, like, 10, 15 people in the room. And everyone was, like, at the end of the photo shoot, they're like, yo, Portia, let's take a picture together. And I went up to Bird. I was like, yo, bro, like, take a pic, man. Like, I don't, you know, like, this don't happen often. Like, I'm a huge boxing fan. Like, this is different, you know what I'm saying? So yeah, that was dope. And we still cool to this day, man. Like, I was at the tower and all that good stuff. Yeah, it's cool.
So what's the if there is a that's kind of in the future, but if there is an end game, what's the end game in your mind? Have you thought that far ahead, or maybe the next big thing, you know?
Man, I don't know. It's kind of difficult because there's like a couple different paths to go. But right now, I think one of the main things that I'm kind of heavily focused on, step one was, you know, like building up all the clientele and like making sure that I deliver positive work and make sure that my name is solid and good. And so now it's like I just got an intern and he was supposed to be here now, but due to COVID, it got canceled. But got my intern from France and he's going to come out here and so I'm having him fly out and just going to build him up. I'm going to start teaching other people, man, how to do, like, how to be great. You know what I mean? Like, I'm not great, but, like, you know, I at least have a vision of what it looks like. Mm-hmm. And so if I can, like, pass off some knowledge and wisdom to people that are going to be in my position one day, not in the position of, like, you know, this ranking, but just in the position of being creative and having, like, being like one of those kids like I was, where you're just super artsy and have no idea what to do with it and not, don't want to be somebody like on the street painting and can't, like, you know, eat a steak when they want, you know, like, I want to teach people how to be able to hone in on their skills and crafts and utilize it to make a better tomorrow. That way we don't have, like, you know, some of these kids like now running around tearing shit, well, tearing up stuff. I'm not completely opposed to, but stealing, that's where I put my foot down, because you taking a Louis Vuitton bag don't have nothing to do with this stuff. So, like, you know, like, I would love to see a bigger, brighter future for kids all around, but you know, also like of my people in general, like, you know, like sometimes people just not given the opportunity, man. So like, I want to do stuff like that. So like I said, yeah, in the future, that's what I'd like to see. Like with my agency that I currently have and all my clients, and just having people work on this and teach a person how to edit this, teach a person how to edit this type of photo, teach a person how to interact with a client, have a conversation, how to get into a situation. Like, yeah, like I want people to be successful. I want everyone to be better than me. Yeah.
Dope, bro. Well, I definitely appreciate you taking the time to join me, Monseé, man. Drop your, if you don't mind, drop your social media anywhere people can follow you, find you.
Yeah, it's Monseé World. It's a M-O-N-S-E-E. It's spelled S-E-E, but it's pronounced Say. So a lot of people call me Monseé. Travis Parker calls me Monseé. Ariana Grande calls me Monseé. Like there's a few of them out there. They know it's messed up, but you know, but it's M-O-N-S-E-E World. So you can Google that on pretty much anything and it'll pop up. That's all of my social media, even stuff that I don't use. I have a OnlyFans account with Monseé World. I don't use it, but I do these things just to where I don't want somebody going and snatching up my name and using it in the wrong way. So I snatch up accounts of my name on everything. So you can find
me. That's smart. Especially when you have a name that stands out. So definitely a smart thing to do. Oh, bro, I appreciate you taking the time. Y'all heard it, Monseé. I'm Source and Company.
Appreciate you, man.